Well, they did all the tests, right? They evaluated him. They made sure he's healthy. UFC being the name that they are, I don't think they're gonna let someone go in there if they're not in the right state. What does kind of seem a little bit off is the fact that they still can't figure out what's going on.
Right.
So I'm like, that's kind of where it's like, well, are you guys being professional with this, or do you guys really want to push this fight? I don't know. My concern is always for him. You know, I said it before, like, even though we're fighting, I still have respect and love for the guy. He has a family, he has a kid, and I don't want to be the guy that triggers something bad that happens with him. I wouldn't like to live with myself with that.
So, and more, I'm glad to fight someone who is really professional, because I'm so tired about these opponents who are not professionals here, who are cannot make the weight. They are all trouble, bringing all trouble. It's making suffering not only me, like opponent, but all fans, all organization, and it's like totally unprofessional. And I would like to have more really responsible fighters inside of the organization.
Like when I seen him and the way he was talking and everything, I was like, I can see myself partying with you, like I can see myself hanging out with you, you know, like he's from Hawaii. I have a lot of love for Hawaiians. We go out there all the time, surf and everything. I even said it before, it's gonna suck, you know, because you have two guys who you know, like, this guy's dope. I consider myself a cool person. But we have nowhere to go, though, you know? And it's like, either you vacate it and you move up a weight class, and then we keep doing this, or we have what we have now, which is where we fight each other.
You've been readying for Brian for most of the year at this point. I'm just curious for your thoughts, having watched him and studied for him. Like, what do you think it is that makes his jiu-jitsu so successful in there?
You know, he's good. He's a dangerous man, you know, but everybody keep talking about Brian and this and that. Everything the guy did, I did better. He's on what, 6-fight win streak? I got 12. He beat a champion, I beat two. And I beat one of them twice. You know, so at the end of the day, the Blessed Express is going around in a circle. We lapping you, bro. You know, and little brother, and I'm younger than you, so you know, congratulations.
And just quickly for Brian, when you hear him say that everything you did, he did better, do you have a response?
Sometimes the best response is no response.
Sometimes you don't have a response, so.
Someone is still delirious.
What'd he say?
I said you're still delirious.
You mentioned earlier if you beat after this Saturday, if you win, you know, you'll be the greatest of all time. What is left for you to achieve then after this event?
Strawweights, bow down. I'm coming back next year. What I'm hearing, there is a rumor, I'm hearing more about Jessica Andrade facing Rose. Rose has only 4 months left to defend her belt. Other way, I don't see other way me fighting for this belt, you know, that's it.
Dana, I'd like your response to that. Obviously, you know, the two-weight champion thing is becoming more commonplace. What would you, you know, if Joanna wins this fight, do you want to see her back at strawweight? Would you like her to stay at this weight and take
who
it from
else
there?
You see? Who else you see? Who else? Who is left? I beat all of them. All of them.
You heard her.
Was there ever part of you that doubted that this fight would come together with him and maybe had to mentally start to begin to turn the page on that?
I mean, like, I always tell everyone right now, lately, especially because it's the most common question. At the end of the day, I really do care about your health and how you are and how you're doing. I know you got a son. I mean, bullshit aside, you know, I know we're fighting all that shit, but I do hope you're all right. He's all right. You know what I'm saying? Like, that, for me, that, you know, it ain't cool if you step in there and you're not physically all right or something's going on. You know, I wouldn't want me to step in there. I wouldn't want him to step in there, especially you got a family. I got my family. So, like I said, I did worry about him. I do. I pray for you, swear to God. And we're going to give you guys the show you guys deserve. And nothing's going to happen.
This is a really huge opportunity for her. I think some people were surprised when they booked this fight. Do you feel like she's on your level, like among the best in the division?
There's levels for this game, you know? And I feel like Nina is a great fighter, but I'm a top five. It's different, you know? There's levels to this game. And when I wanted to fight, she was the only one stepping in, so I took the fight.
Was there any hesitance on your part to wait for someone higher ranked, or is that just you wanted to fight, so you just took it?
I wanted to fight someone higher ranked, but there was nobody for this card. There was nobody on that time, so I just took that fight. I have way more experience than her. I feel like I'm better than her. I'm well-rounded. I know everything that can happen in there. We trained together in the past, and I feel like I'm way better than her.
Elias, you're on like a really nice run now at this point. 4 wins in your last 5. Where do you feel like you stand in this crowded middleweight division at this point?
Well, currently 13th or 14th, obviously. And, you know, Eric Anders is a very tough individual. He's just about right up there. He has that killer mentality, as we've seen in regards to his debut against Rafael Natal. And then you also see the Tim Williams fight, where he was arguably losing part of it and then came up with that, you know, kick to send Tim's head into the bleachers. So, you know, he has a tough mentality to him, and he's a badass. But I think, again, time and time again, I've been in there with, you know, more well-rounded fighters, tougher fighters, collectively in regards to my overall record. Even if you kind of dig into his record and previously and before the UFC, some of the guys, you know, had 50-50 records and whatnot. But that is still mat time that allow him to, you know, get into his rhythm and get into his style. It's a ferocious style that puts pressure. But I've been here before, and I'll keep being here because I'm in top 15 and soon to be higher.
Come on.
Oh my God.
Sit.
That's adorable.
Hey. Athena, sit.
That is adorable.
Pretty much don't do anything without my dog, so. She's the reason I'm not crazy. You know, it comes from a childhood. You know, I've never really spoke a lot about it. I think there's been some, you know, lots of controversy people have heard about, you know, me and my father. You know, I was raised in a very abusive household. My dad was an old school tradesman, so he was a very, very tough man. And he got kind of thrown into fatherhood in a way that I don't think he was really quite ready for. And then you get a female just like him who's very strong-minded and very tough. And it was definitely a challenge. And when I left home at 18, I found strong sound. I found fighting and was still kind of mixed up at that time in life. You know, I enrolled myself in college because I thought it was the right thing to do. In all reality, it wasn't what I wanted. I was just trying to find myself so that when I found fighting, it was like a way to express myself. And I've, you know, grown up and found those challenges even through my 20s. It's like, you don't really understand how important your 20s are. Then you get in your 30s and you're like, oh, it all makes sense. That's why it all happened.
What did you think of Joanna getting the next title shot without having to compete at flyweight?
I think it's terrible for our weight class. I think that those kinds of fights are what, you know, maybe I don't even know that the fans really care to see, but it mixes up the division. Like, if you want these divisions to have true stances and you want to go to, like, oh, this is the world title or this is, you know, a stable weight class, then you can't be mixing people up. You know, I think that it wouldn't be what I wanted to do. So, I mean,
no. Jimmy, I mean, at this point, you know, you've been in this game 10 years. You know, are there still big improvements you find that you can make in your game? Like, has your routine in the gym changed at this point over the course of, you know?
Yeah, 100%. I'm still learning. I'm still learning in the gym every day. I haven't got a lot of mileage on the clock either. I might be 38, but I haven't had many wars in fights. I can think about, at my 20, 21 fights, I think I've had about 3 wars in there. So you know, I can still make a lot of improvements, and I'm still learning every day.
When I started, it was a lot about, you know, it's grappling and then striking and wrestling. But after a while, like first, the wrestling and grappling becomes one. That's how it was with me. It just all became grappling. And then once you've been doing this for a while, and then I guess as well, the way we trained for this camp was everything was pretty much mixed together the whole time. So yeah, it just, you don't think about things separately. It's all the same, you know.
That my man right here is going to try out, and the way it works is this. Brian gets down, back mount is the most important position in jiu-jitsu. If you get here, the fight could be over. But the back mount doesn't matter unless you can keep the back mount. No matter what, don't let go, keep your head, look away, bite your teeth, not your tongue, head down champ, hold on tight, stay on for 10 seconds, we're all going to count you down. If you stay on, you get the t-shirt. If not, we give it to that other kid over there. Are you guys ready? Here we go, on your mark. Get set. Don't let go. Go. 10. Count it down. 9. 8. Louder. 7. 6. 5. 4. 3. 2. 1. The champ! Congratulations. Hook him up. Hook him up.
Down, bro.
Already signed. Now, run.
Valentina Shevchenko in tremendous shape this week.
One twenty-three
and a half for Valentina Shevchenko. She comes in.
She even did the pre, like, announcement post. They would tell you not to do, but that's how confident she was. It didn't matter.
Compete for 3 UFC titles.
She is a quarter.
123 and a half for a woman who challenged for both of our titles.
Because I'm holding my breath.
I don't know that she
will be able to take that fight now. Brian Ortega up next, one half of our main event.
Another big ovation.
The champ, Max Holloway. Ooh, he gets a rousing introduction. He is already shirtless. He is ready to do this. Brian Ortega challenging for the featherweight title here on Saturday.
Max Holloway, the UFC featherweight champion, makes it a half a pound to go, and he shushes the critics. He's got this under control. We have a main event.
That's a fire. That's a fiery step to the scale. I don't know if you can have a fiery step to the scale.
Official weight, 144.5, and a champion!
Yeah, it was a weird thing from the referee. First, the knees, the illegal knees on my head, and the second, the stoppage. But what can I do?
When you get kneed in the head like that illegally, what's going through your mind? Is it frustrating because you think you're getting hurt?
Yeah, I was talking to the referee before the fight about this, and he was explaining me 3 points are okay, 4 points are not okay. So when he started to kneeing me, I was 3 points, 2 feet, one hand. And then I realized, okay, it's the old rules. I put the other hand, so four points, and he cannot knee me. But he keep doing, and the referee didn't stop. And I realized, okay, the referee don't do it, so I have to handle myself and get back up and break the clinch and finish the fight.
Did you know it was over the moment?
For sure, man. You know, I said in an interview before, man, guys that hit guys like that after a punch like that, they're douches, man. You know, you can see it. You can see, like, somebody falls, their hands are down, and they're looking up. It's like, what are you going to hit them for, you know? If he fell and did this right away, then, of course, you got to go for the kill, you know? But somebody falls with their hand down and their eyes, it's like, no emotions in the world. I don't care how happy you are. You're able to see that, you know? And, you know, I saw it. I knew it was over.
I would think, though, after losses and frustration, it might be hard, like, to not take out your frustrations on this guy.
That's exactly what I mean. You know, I had a lot of it, and I still saw it. So if somebody ever says, oh, it's just emotions got to me, they're lying. You know, that's bull. They're lying, and they're just mean.
Can you rank the top 5 dorkiest fighters?
So... you know what? I don't want it to be a contest, but like, the style bender, he's big into, I know he's too big into the anime, Roxanne Modafferi. You know, to me, those would be the top two. I don't know. I haven't really been picking out, but like, they're like hardcore into the anime. So that's pretty cool. Like, I never followed it too much, but I was in a chess club, so, you know, I took a different side of the dorkiness. So it's like liking your anime, hardcore comics, and then there's like playing chess and I guess doing sciencey stuff. So I'm in that group.
You guys help, all right? I do all the interviews. Anytime any of you have ever reached out to me, I am the kindest person. You know, I mean, I know I'm a fighter, like that's what it is that I do, but like I have shih tzus at home. I love cooking. You know, I'm a kind person, but it is a job to me, and I'm trying to change my life. You know, I'm a single girl that pays all my own bills, and you know, I've dedicated my full life to this. I need to make I need to make some money. I mean, who can retire off fighting if you don't make it to the highest level? And at this point, I feel I deserve it. I have weathered every storm. I have never said no to any fight that the UFC has ever given to me, and I've also been kind of thrown around, you know, like people have like, oh, Jessica, you get the Paige fight, then no, that's not there, then you get the Sarge fight, then that's not there, and then, you know, one more fight, and you get to fight the bantamweight title, and then you don't get that, so it's like, you know, like, I did it, guys, like, help, you're the media sources, you know, that comes from you too, you know, just like you sit here and you interview all of us and you show up, you know, help us fighters sometimes, help the good people. You know, promote the good things. You have that voice. You know, do something good with it, too.
The amount of blood that was pouring out there at that point, did that freak you out even a little bit? I mean, what was going through your mind at that point?
I was just thinking, the choke is going to be slippery and nice, you know? I thought he was going to try to spin, you know, maybe give off his back and try to get a scramble. That's what I was expecting, and I was going to try to catch him in that transition, but he did not. He stayed there, probably trying to ride out the round or get a stand up. So when I was recovered, I kind of figured out that he was not going anywhere. I always thought he was about to explode and stuff like that. But I caught him with that nice elbow that opened him wide up. And then another one followed, I do believe. I don't know if that hit on the same spot, but it was a nasty cut, all right, and that's really what finished the fight.
You know, I'm looking forward. It was first fight in the flyweight division, and right away fight with such a tough opponent with Valentina and for the belt. I'm happy. I'm proud of myself. I broke Ronda Rousey's record of title fights. I'm very happy, and yeah, that's it. I must take some time off, watch the fight, and talk to my coaches Dana and decide what's going to be the next step. Yeah, we will see. I felt so good this fight week. The whole camp, I put on a hell of a work, and I'm proud of myself. Like I said, in this sport, we don't take second place. And you know, I don't want to say this because of my loss, but I said this during the week that here shouldn't be like, okay, one person is winning, one is losing, but like even the person who lost is not a loser, you know. So that's the thing, and I felt good in the flyweight division. I see how my body reacted to the diet and few more pounds. I was happy, in good mood. I could do more, and definitely it's a good division for me.
It was everything that I was expecting from Joanna. I knew it will be good fight, it will be tough fight, because she's tough opponent. She's not the one who give up easily, no. And I would say that I'm happy to get this belt from this kind of fights, when you are facing real opponent, not just like any opponent, because when you get it from the real fight, only this way you can prove that you are real champion.
What do you attribute your great improvement to from 5 years ago to now? That's, 5 years is not a long time, but you are a dramatically different guy. What do you attribute the improvement to?
Our great coaches. I'm about to give you three names. Write them down. They're gonna go in the history book. Rylan Lazarus, Ivan Flores, and Darren Yap. The three-headed beast. These guys is animals. These guys break down a lot of stuff. You know, even my wrestling coach, Michael Nakagawa, he's a fighter. He's coming up. My brother. And but those guys, those three guys and those four guys, they put it on the line for me all the time. Those four guys right there is their brains behind. I'm just a guy. I'm just a guy doing it. But their brains putting it behind me. So, I love those guys. You know, when you're in there, you see things. You know, I just felt his energy dropping every round. I heard his coaches talking, you know, in the first couple rounds, and he'd push, and then, you know, around like the third round and stuff, I heard his coaches talking, and there's no push anymore, you know. And then when I was coming out of the third round, I told Joe, this is the round. Get ready to come in and talk to me. And then when I didn't get the finish, I walked straight to Joe. Then I was like, this close. Maybe next one. And then when they called the fight, I jumped the cage. The first guy I talked to was Joe. I was like, hey, I guess I was right. I take it back. We was there.
Thanks, Max.
Thank you. Thank you, guys.
All done? Max, we have a picture?
Yeah.